Today we shall try and understand the concept of Hunter-Schrager bands. What are these? These are basically alternating light and dark bands that we see in enamel under reflected light of a longitudinally cut tooth. So I'll just show you how they appear before we go into the description of it. See, here are the dark bands alternating with light bands. This is the enamel portion. So these are the dark bands and these are the light bands. So these are the alternating dark and light bands, and the bands and that are called as the Hunter-Schrager bands. We'll understand what exactly it is. It is thought to be an optical phenomenon. Where do we see it? We see it in the enamel. Under what section? We see it under longitudinal ground sectioned tooth. Under what light? Under reflected light. What forms such Hunter-Schrager bands? Let's try and understand that. When enamel is being formed by the amyloblast, when it is laying down the enamel, it takes a wavy course. It won't be running in a straight path like this. It can't, because of the robust activity that is happening inside the amyloblast. It keeps on moving upwards and downwards in different directions until it reaches the surface, where it just takes a straighter path near the surface. So in the most portion of the enamel rods will be in a wavy pattern. So lot of groups of rods running like this in a wavy pattern, and some of them will be crossed over, called as synchronous decussation. Some of the prisms will run in another direction, opposite direction to these rods. This is a 3D image. Please imagine it in a 3D image. All these rods are in a wavy pattern towards you. Okay, it's a wavy pattern towards you. So when you cut, you will be seeing them as dots. I will just try and draw another image to show the alternating wavy pattern or decussation pattern. So this is a portion of enamel where the enamel in one portion is running. Please imagine this is the 3D image. A group of rods, around say 10 to 15 rods, will run in this direction, okay, and another group of rods will be wavy but in a longitudinal direction. See, group of rods running like this and another group of rods running like this, bent towards you. And next set will be wavy but in a longitudinal direction. So this, eventually when we give a cut to this, all these portions of rods will be cross cut and they will appear as dots. Okay, they'll appear as dots, and these dots, when light is put on them, will absorb the light and this will appear dark band, as dark band, and this dark band is called as the diazone. And the portion where it is longitudinally cut, okay, this longitudinally cut portion which reflects the light, it will, when the light is put upon it, it will reflect back the light and absorber will be able to see the light, and that band is called as the light band or the para zone. It's called as the para zone. So now we have alternating bands of diazones and parazones, and that is caused because of the difference in the orientation of the wavy rods. And when we give a cut, some of them are transversely cut and some of them are longitudinally cut. And transversely cut will appear dark and called as diazones because they absorb the light, and the longitudinally cut rods will reflect the light and they will be appearing as light bands, and they are called as the parazones. Now we will try and see that why we don't see the rods, the bands near the surface and around 30 microns near the dentinal enamel junction, because in those portions the rods run take a straighter path. They take a straighter path because of which those zones are not showing darkened light bands. Here is something that I have arranged to show the direction of the enamel rods. Here a set of matchsticks that are kept in one direction and the middle set are in a longitudinal direction, and the, again the another set in the perpendicular to the longitudinal section of matchsticks. This is the way the rods are arranged in the enamel running from dentinal enamel junction to the surface. So towards the surface they are straight, but in the middle portion they are quite wavy. And please imagine that these matchsticks, which are perpendicular to the longitudinal ones, the ends of it are basically turning towards the DEG and attaching there. And so it's quite wavy. They are attached to one end to the DEG and the other end to the surface. So they turn again, take another wavy course. So these are not just, this is only a portion of the enamel rods kept like this. Okay, the other one end to the DEG, the other end for the front end will turn again, take another wavy course to attach to the surface. And the second set, which are running longitudinally from DEG to the surface, will look like this when the sections are made. The below again are running another set of rods running perpendicular to the longitudinal ones. So eventually we get, when we cut in a longitudinal section, we get two kinds of rods cut. That is one which are cross cut or transversely cut, which will be seen as dots, and the ones which are longitudinally cut, which will be seen as long lines. So the dotted ones are the they absorb, the cross cut ones will absorb the light and give the dark zones called as diazones. The longitudinal ones, which will be cut in long axis, will reflect the light and hence will be light zone, and that's called as the parazone. What is the significance of this arrangement of enamel rods? It is mainly this pattern, HSP pattern, have evolved to optimize resistance to attrition, resistance to abrasion, resistance to tooth fraction or propagation of the tooth fracture. It won't allow the fracture to traverse through it. If a fracture line appears here, it will not be traveling in a straight path. So it will be very difficult when the rods are stacked up in different directions for the crack to propagate through them. So this how enamel is given as the strongest substance in the body, because of the arrangement of these rods and also the orientation of crystals. It's not just the direction of the rod that it takes from DEG to the surface. It is also the, some of the authors also say that it is the orientation of crystals inside, hydroxyapatite crystals inside, also change in the organic content of the enamel in these regions. So there is change in orientation of crystals, organic content, and also the wave pattern of the enamel rods. All these give the pattern of Hunter-Schäger bands. Now let's start drawing Hunter-Schäger bands, for which we need three pencils: one regular lead pencil, and a darker 8B pencil and a light shade of blue colored pencil. Now, as always, we will draw a neat circle. One side of the page. And we divide the portion of tooth into a small area of pulp, dentino-enamel junction. From pulp surface to dentino-enamel junction will be dentin area. And a portion of enamel surface. Now, to begin with, we will draw the dentinal tubules, a shaped curvature. Though this is a diagram of Hunter-Shager bands, we should take care to draw a very neat dentine portion with nice dentinal tubules. Use a sharp pencil to draw these tubules. This way, once we finish the dentinal tubules, we shall shade the area of enamel. This one we are seeing under the reflected light microscopy. So we'll shade this with light blue mixed with the gray shade. It's your choice whether you want to use the gray shade or not. I'm just giving a thin coating of gray over the blue shaded area. The reflection of light depends on what part of the enamel the light has fallen on. So that orientation of crystals will reflect a particular shade of light, and that's what we see. In this blue shaded area, we shall do the banding, the darker zones. Which are broader towards the dentinoenamel junction and taper as they go to the surface and fade just short of the enamel surface. It said that it occupies to 2/3 of the enamel space from dentinoenamel junction. You can see that on the outermost layer of enamel, we don't see Hunter-Shager bands because the rods run straight in this region of enamel. Now, we have to take care to shade all dark in these two regions where the light has got absorbed. So, there is no reflection because this is the empty part of the slide. Once we finish shading that area, we shall shade the pulpal portion, which is also an empty space and will be seen as dark area. So this is the drawing of Hunter-Shager band. We shall start labeling it. Now we should label every part of the tooth to begin with. So that is, this portion is enamel, this is dentin, this is the pulp region. Now these are the dark bands called as diazones. These are light bands. Sorry. Called parazones. So altogether, this is the Hunter-Shaker band diagram, and this is dentino enamel junction. You can see these dark bands appear dark because the light gets absorbed here, nothing gets reflected back. So the portion of rods which are cross cut, which are transversely cut, will absorb the light and they appear dark. Whereas this portion of the band where the the enamel rods run longitudinal and are cut longitudinally, they will reflect the light towards the observer, and hence we see it as light bands called as parazones. So this is Hunter-Shaker bands for you. Hope you like this. We'll come back with another diagram soon. See you all. Bye.